Standby.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari, our live safaris that we bring you every day, twice a day, here on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park of South Africa. We're currently heading up Vuyatela Main Access in order to get to Sydney's Dam to see if those lions are still about and on their buffalo kill. Well, for those of you who are joining us for the first time, my name is Jamie, and this morning I have Dave on camera with me on this brisk, cold morning out here in the game reserve in the Lowveld. Brent is out with Jandre on the other vehicle, and Dave, you might be slightly offended. I'm sorry I didn't provide you with a hot water bottle. Brent gave one to Jandre, but there wasn't an extra one going around. Oh yes, that's true. Dave has got the most fantastic pair of earmuffs on that he found in his room. They're a fluffy grey colour. They could only be more ridiculous if they were bright pink. It is cold this morning. It is 11 degrees centigrade, so 51 Fahrenheit. We're not even right sort of smack bang in the middle of winter, but already we're starting to feel the winter's chill. The days are getting short, which also means that we will be changing our times from the 1st of June. The morning safari, the sunrise safari, will be shifting to half an hour later. Which means that for Eastern time, it will be from 12:30 at night to 3:30 in the morning. It'll be for all of you night owls out there in the States. And then on the other side of the States, it will be at 9:30 at night to 12:30 at night. There you go. Don't forget, from the 1st of June we will be shifting half an hour later. Might give us half an hour extra warmth. We shall see how it goes. Oh, some interesting things happening with the lion dynamics at the moment. The Nkuhumas have killed a buffalo, and it's confirmed now. The Nkuhumas have killed a buffalo up on Sydney's Dam. However, the kicker comes in the sudden arrival of Junior back on the scene. We've been waiting for this moment for him to reappear. We know that he's been wandering about, keeping himself relatively, what would be the word? Well, at least out of harm's way. However, Junior has made a very bad decision in returning to the females, and who knows how last night played out. It is the one way, it's one of the big ways that a young male lion can draw attention to himself, is by associating with females. And the Birmingham boys, who control this part of the territory, the male coalition of four males, are not going to be very impressed with the return of the Nkuhuma male. And if that sounds like some kind of strange language to those of you who are new to the show, Junior was a cub of the Nkuhumas. And he left the pride, as all male lions do, at around 3 years old. He sort of came and went and disappeared towards the end of last year, wandered about the Kruger, down to Mala Mala, up to Simbambili, so all surrounding our area. And now he's gone back to his mother and his sisters and his aunts. Definitely not the best idea he's ever had. And we've got to keep our fingers crossed, unfortunately for him, that he must actually go again. He must disappear again, because this has not been his smartest move. Unfortunately for us, the buffalo kill was a little bit outside of our traverse area. So whilst the lions were visible from our side of the boundary, we cannot go everywhere within this great 4 million hectare piece of property. We're limited to where we can go, so we had to watch sort of from the other side of the dam. What that means is that we don't know how big that buffalo carcass actually was. We know that the hyenas were hanging about. It remains to be seen if those lions are still there or if they have decided to move off and leave the rest to the hyenas. And if they have, we'll see if we can work out where they've gone. But if they have and they've moved outside of our traverse area, then I really think that it is time to break this leopard drought that I've been experiencing. It's time to find a leopard. We tried especially hard yesterday, not that we don't always try very hard. But we searched and searched for Tingana, the big male leopard of this area. And James Richards tells us that today is the 1 month anniversary since we last saw Tingana. That is ridiculous. We need to rectify that. I think there's a reason for that. I think that he has been patrolling the outskirts of his territory more and more, with Gijima hanging about the northern part of his territory and with other young males being present, with Kanuma sort of maybe not necessarily wandering into Tingana's territory, but certainly passing through it. Perhaps he feels threatened in that way. But he came through yesterday. We know that his tracks came onto the property. We just couldn't figure out exactly where he went. Oh, 1 month since we last saw Tingana. I think that we need to remedy that. Not like Tingana to disappear for extended periods of time. Hello, Lloyd, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. Lloyd is a new viewer and is a little bit concerned about our safety in terms of a lion or a tiger attack. Well, Lloyd, I'm fairly certain I'm safe from a tiger attack. We should be just fine, since this is not an area where you will find tigers. We're right at the top northeastern corner of South Africa. There are no tigers here, but we do have lions and we do have leopards. However, rest assured that the only thing that this open car is exposing us to is the rather chilly morning and the wind chill factor as we drive along. I can guarantee we are absolutely safe. We are also, of course, all of us have been doing this job for several years, so we're very experienced in terms of watching and keeping an eye on animal behavior. So whilst these animals have all grown up with open top vehicles around them, they don't view us as food in any way. It's still important that we never become blasé about it. You'll find that we continually assess every situation whenever we go and view an animal. And it is exceptionally rare for an animal to attack an open safari vehicle. It's basically unheard of, and it's almost always when there is something wrong with that animal for some reason, whether they be injured or ill or old or something along those lines. However, I'm not the only one out here heading out to see if we can find the lions. Brent is also out with Jandre, and he would like to say good morning to you all.
Good morning and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Jandre Gerding on camera, and we're in search of Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard on Juma. It is bitterly cold. It is 11 degrees Celsius, 51 Fahrenheit, and I think it's our coldest morning so far. But we can suffer the cold if we find the cats. So that's what we're trying to do. And this area is an area we see Karula in quite often, so we're just looking for some tracks in this early morning. You can see the light in the east starting to show. So hopefully we're going to have some luck on this Sunday early, early morning. Most people are having a sleep in. We're out in search of lions and leopards. I wouldn't want it any other way. So we're busy traversing the southern side of Juma Private Game Reserve in hopes of seeing some leopard tracks. And if you happen to have just stumbled upon us, we're in the Greater Kruger National Park in northeastern South Africa. We're part of a 13 million acre open system. It is just for the wild animals. And we're hoping to show you a few of those this morning. One thing, let me just turn that down. Good morning, Deborah, the armchair traveller. Deborah would like to know if anyone's seen Tundi. Tundi is another female leopard. She holds territory to the east of us here. And she was mating with the dominant male, Tingana, recently. And Debbie would like to know if there's been any sign of her showing pregnancy. Was the mating successful? I'm afraid, Debbie, I haven't seen her. She's been seen a bit around Chitwa Chitwa. But no, I haven't heard anything saying that she is showing signs of being pregnant. It's possible, but one must remember they don't always conceive after every mating. So only time will tell, Deborah. Oh, little Steenbok dashed across the road. But Jamie's got two carnivores to show you in one spot.
Two carnivores, but not the sort we thought, and in fact it's actually not two carnivores, there are three. There are two hyenas here munching on some scraps, one calling off in the distance. I'm just going to be quiet so you can hear that. And then, sorry, I have to redirect your attention. Just have a look here. Off to the left. Look who's come to join. A side-striped jackal, tentatively approaching the hyenas. It wants to grab a snack, and in typical jackal fashion, hanging around the outskirts, just waiting for that briefest lapse in attention before it dashes forward to grab whatever it can. Okay, so it was a young buffalo. That definitely helps us out. Oh, stand off. Oh, I love scenes like this. Jackals are just so gutsy in terms of their approach to scavenging. Having a look around where they were feeding. Yep, I'm just going to sit here. Don't mind me. I'm just going to sit and wait. Oh. Actually, that was getting a bit scary. Establishing a little bit of a safer distance. This is so wonderful. We don't often get to see jackals scavenging here. We don't actually have that many jackals. There's been something of a population drop, as far as I can tell. But Sydney's Dam definitely greeting us with some interesting play out between different scavenging species. Where are you going, jackal? I'm going to try from a different angle this time. Basically the South African equivalent of a fox. He's filling essentially the same ecological niche. There's more hyenas calling off to the west. And there you go. It's not often that we get a sort of a scale. I'm going to take the light off now. I don't think we need it anymore. But many of you commenting on the difference in size between the jackal and the hyena. And yes, I mean, a jackal is, as I said, essentially the same size as a fox. Whereas a hyena, big solid hyena, anywhere from 60 to 90 kilograms, 120 to close to 190 pounds in weight. They are large animals. They're big, big stocky animals. And the jackal, much more suited to patiently awaiting its turn. Clever little opportunists. either scavenging from carcasses like this, or eating berries, little rodents, arthropods, whatever they can find. The side-striped jackal knows just how to play this situation. Oh, big yawn. Now, I've been witness once to a scene where the matriarch of a hyena clan, not here, where in another place that I used to work, where she'd brought back half an impala for her young cubs. Her cubs were actually too young to eat meat at that point. It was just to sort of get them interested in the whole idea of what they'll be doing for the rest of their lives. And during that time, a jackal actually entered the scene at the hyena den and displayed great courage in terms of creeping forward right next to her cubs and snapping up bits of impala as he went along. The matriarch just kind of half growled at him. And since this is the time of the scavengers, the hyenas are not going to go out of their way to try and chase that jackal away. He's smaller, or she is smaller, faster, and just generally more agile. It's that typical upright posture. A true member of the canid family. Now, unlike the hyena, it doesn't really have the jaw strength to crush into bones, as Dina was wondering, whether or not the jackal can eat bones like a hyena. Not really. They're kind of like toothpicks. They might be able to crush the smaller bones, but in a buffalo carcass like that, that would be exceptionally limited, and the chances are that the lions would already have crushed the softer, smaller pieces of bone. The jackal might chew on them a bit, maybe crack off a little bit around the edges, but other than that, he's not going to be crunching through the bones. He'll be looking for bits of skin, maybe just a little bit of meat every now and again. Hello. Now, for those of you who are joining us for the first time, to get to see a jackal like this is actually really special. As I said, they are quite rare out here at the moment, which is not something I ever thought I'd be saying. I've always lived in places where it's just teeming with jackal, but apparently they do go through these population dips. Shame, he's actually a little bit cold. Oh, yeah, maybe there's something there. Have a bit of a sniff around. Take your chances. Another brave advance. We've got, I'm not sure which hyena we've got here. You see, we're quite far away. Just trying to figure it out. Doesn't look like we have, it looks like we've got one of the just sub-adults, or almost adults at this point, scavenging off the carcass. Either way, it is most definitely not either of the three main high-ranking females that we are so familiar with, which is interesting. I wonder if they've already eaten their fill, or if these hyena just got lucky. Somehow I don't think they just got lucky. I think that that entire clan would have had to spend time chasing the lions off that kill. Oh, jackal, don't go away. I think the jackal just got bored there. Decided to have a little bit of a trot around in a circle, warm up a bit, and then it will be back. Maybe even, though, returning to the original site of the kill in the hope that there might be some scraps there. Good morning to Janet in Ontario, who has been doing some reading on jackals and read that they're quite fussy eaters and that they'll take certain organs and leave the others. In my experience, I've never seen jackal scavenging off really rotten carcasses. Oh, there he goes. He's actually trotting right away. Seeking up other opportunities for now. He'll be back. He or she will be back. Janet? Absolutely. Like all of the scavenging animals, or even the general predators, they have preferences for certain organs. So if they can, the liver, the kidney, the heart, the lungs, those are all really, really nutrient-rich parts of the animal. So they'll try and get to those first, but obviously in an opportunity like this, they're going to have to take what they can get. So I've seen jackal eat pieces of, or gnaw on pieces of skin, gnaw on bits of bone, meat. I've never seen them being too fussy. And I said that they're opportunists, and they really are. They'll eat fruit, they will eat bits of meat. They really are just general, almost omnivores in their dietary sort of requirements, if I could put it that way. So whilst I've never seen one feed off an old carcass, I wouldn't dismiss the possibility. The hyenas have sort of half looked up every now and again, not terribly interested in what that jackal was doing. Sandy, you were wondering if the hyenas would kill the jackal. Yes, potentially, if they could catch him. It is actually really unlikely. So these sorts of scenes with hyena and jackal play out pretty much every single day out here in the African bush. Usually the hyenas can't be bothered to chase after a jackal. You will get rare situations. The same goes for lions and leopards. You will get rare situations where the jackal has pushed the boundaries a little bit too much. Sometimes, particularly with grumpy male lions, where they actually react and manage to catch them. And that's only where the jackal has got cocky, essentially. Really just overpushed the boundaries and tried to get too close too soon, instead of patiently waiting their turn. So it's not... Hyena was looking up there for a second at the flock of hardy-dars. I did just see another hyena, but I can't work out exactly where it's gone. Oh, hardy-dars have changed their mind. They are coming back. All has become quite peaceful here. Brent has found you one of the biggest animals that you could see in the African bush.
So, unfortunately, no leopard yet, but we do have some elephant bulls. And they're busy dismembering a poor little bush willow at the moment. And there's some more to our right we can't see yet. There's the one we're looking at. There's another slightly younger one to his left. And quickly back to Jamie!
Look at what we've got. We've now got the second species of jackal that we get out here. At first I sort of dismissed it as the side-striped jackal returning. However, that is absolutely not the case. We now have a black-backed jackal who has decided to chance his luck. Let's see, he's going to pop out any moment now, hopefully, behind the bushes. Yes, no? Where did you go? There we go. Here he comes, straight up to the hyenas, again displaying that boldness right behind them. Now you can actually really see where the name black-backed comes from. They've almost got like a saddle on their backs, totally different from the almost solid grey-like colour of a side-striped jackal, and the tail's different as well. Ooh, that was brave. A little bit too confident there. We've got a play out between two of the most adaptable and cunning of the scavenger species. All watched over, actually. We're going to tear our eyes away from the jackal ever so quickly. We'll come back to it in a moment because I know that you don't often get to see them. Oh, it's gone. There was a hyena over there. It was one of the big females, but she's moved off. Sorry. All right, let's go back to our jackal then. Let's not take our eyes off it for too long. I promise you there was a hyena standing there. And she'd been standing there like a statue for the last sort of 2 minutes. But then, live wildlife filming, if you take your eye off them for 2 seconds, you never know what's going to happen. Now, Laura, you were wondering about, because they really do have a very dog-like quality to them, you were wondering whether a jackal has ever been domesticated. Yes, I've heard of a few people having pet jackals, particularly in farms. Most of the time, unfortunately, jackal are treated very much like vermin in South Africa. Not here. We're very fortunate here in that we are in an entirely protected area, and every single species has the right to be protected and is left unmolested. But you do get people who've kept jackal as pets. Obviously, with that risk, you have to be well house-trained, I suppose. And most of you know my feelings on keeping wild animals as pets. Jackal, whilst they can be kept, never truly get rid of that wild instinct in them. Just like those people who have tamed foxes, there's always that chance that something could go wrong. Personally, I feel as though we've got enough domestic pets to keep ourselves occupied and have company. We no need to add wild animals to the list. It's relatively rare that they're kept as sort of rodent control and so on around farms. Most of the time, unfortunately, farmers are not terribly happy to see jackal. Off he goes. Oh, we've had now the two species of jackal come through. And Dara in Ohio, you were wondering whether or not the side-striped and the black-backed get along. Pretty much. They don't breed with each other. They are two entirely separate species. And that, of course, being the definition of a species, being able to breed with each other, members of the same species, and produce viable offspring. So black-backed jackal and side-striped jackal in a natural environment will never interbreed, but they don't get on all that badly. They fill almost exactly the same ecological niche. The side-stripe is slightly bigger. It might take a more dominant role, but we could easily, in that situation, we could easily have had both species together hanging around that kill with relatively little antagonism towards each other. However, both of them have decided that they are not going to have a chance with these hyena. The hyenas haven't so much fed on this bit of carcass, they just sort of dragged it around. And that's where those big drag marks that we sometimes see in the road come from, actions like this. Where are you going with that? Away. Just away to where I can nibble on it all by myself. And just to finish off our chat about the difference between a side-striped and a black-backed jackal, we have a question about whether or not anybody can tell the difference between their tracks, or if there is a difference in their tracks. And Virginia and Kentucky, you were wondering about that. Oh, yum. That looks like a very appealing breakfast. Virginia, not that I can tell the difference between. There are those who can. The side-striped is slightly bigger. There's a slight difference in what is known in tracking circles as negative space, the gap between the toes and the back pad. I cannot, for the life of me, tell the difference, and I don't begin to claim to. They're very, very similar. Pretty much identical. Just an ever so slight difference. Now, Rhenius could probably tell the difference. I can't. Rhenius being the gentleman that was brought in to help us learn a bit more about tracking. He runs a tracking school at Londolozi. Not much left of that carcass. I mean, that's mostly skin and the legs of the buffalo. Very little meat around there. The skin's also very tough, very difficult to chew around. Now, although it looks like a big piece of carcass, there's actually very little meat left on it. However, this hyena doesn't look like it's suffering. It looks like it's had a good meal last night. And really, this is just pecking at the end of a meal. both instances with our jackal, as our hyenas continue to feast, in both instances we saw those two jackal on their own. But Lady Luga, you were wondering which species travels on their own. The answer is both of them to an extent. There isn't a massive difference in terms of the social structure of the backback and the side striped jackal. Both of them mate for life and are monogamous. And obviously, when I say they mate for life, that is entirely dependent on their survival and avoidance of other predators. But they'll mate for life and they'll live in little family groups, but they'll often move about and forage and scavenge on their own. But in places where they have their den sites or their burrows that they keep their pups, you'll see them together in the little family groups. It'll be a male and a female, their grown offspring at times, or semi-grown offspring, and then the newest set of pups. Now, that is something that I would absolutely love to show you on these live safaris, is a jackal pup. It has got to be one of the cutest little... I mean, any baby animal is cute. Even baby crocodiles are cute. But jackal pups are like little fuzzy creatures. And Rachel, you were wondering on the subject of how we watch this hyena drag the carcass away again, basically playing keep away from the other. You're wondering about how many jackal pups a jackal has. Between 2 to 4 is the average. They can have up to 6, but 2 to 4 would be the average. They're not enormous pups, not like the other member of the dog family, the wild dog, where the female is capable of having up to 20 pups in one litter. The jackal, slightly smaller and slightly more limited. The reason, of course, that a wild dog can afford to have so many babies, or has evolved to have so many babies, is that she's got an entire pack to help care for them. Whereas the jackal only have their partner and sometimes their offspring from the previous litter to help them out. And a very warm welcome to Dave. I don't know, I'm actually going to speak to Dave, the cameraman, now first. Aren't you glad we found a static sighting? Oh, we haven't had to drive anywhere in the cold. I've just thought about that. But good morning to Dave, the viewer. And Dave, the viewer, would like to know, is we've been watching this hyena kind of lift and drag this carcass around and around. You're wondering, what's the furthest distance that I've ever heard of or seen any predator drag a carcass? Well, hyenas definitely hold down that record. Even a leopard will only drag a carcass as far as they need to in order to get it to a nice big tree or a nice safe spot to feed on. Whereas spotted hyena, in limited instances, will drag food right back to the den, regardless of how far they are away. I've tracked drag marks that extend easily 5 to 8 kilometers in length. That's exceptionally far. I mean, that's the exception rather than the rule. But an average of 2 to 3 kilometers is pretty simple for a powerful animal like a hyena. That is about as far as I've ever heard them dragging it. I've never heard of them dragging it any further, but I suspect that they do. I have read books that suggest that hyenas could drag a carcass up to 10, 20 kilometers. Now, that's in this area, Dave. Of course, if you have a look at the research into hyenas around Eastern Africa, Tanzania, or let's say Zimbabwe or Botswana. Oh, what was that all about? Oh, vulture. Oh, that's awesome. How cool is that? A hooded vulture just came in to chance his luck, met with much more resistance than the jackals were, and this could be absolutely awesome, because enough vultures are capable of standing up and challenging a group of hyena. Two young and inexperienced hyena there, faced with scavengers now on both sides of them. No, I wonder if that jackal's not going to come back now that the odds are being slowly tipped against the hyenas. The hyenas, of course, are bigger and stronger than all of the other scavengers here, but if they're outnumbered and kept distracted, then they're going to struggle to keep track of what's going on around them. Here you go, there's the hooded vulture. And if they don't stick close to their kill, somebody's going to manage to pinch a piece. Dave, sorry, I was in the process of answering your question before I got distracted by the hooded vulture. All I wanted to say was in places where the distribution of hyenas is sort of much less concentrated, if they've got much wider spaces, I've read stories in Kenya and Tanzania of female hyenas with cubs having to travel enormous distances to get to a kill and then return back to the den site day after day. And when the cubs are old enough, there's a chance they're going to start dragging carcasses up to 20 or more kilometers back towards the den site. But it'll only be a little piece of it. It won't be the whole carcass. These are young hyenas. You can tell just in the way they've responded to this. So an experienced female or experienced male would just sit tight right at the carcass itself and not concern themselves with the actions of the thieves hanging around the outskirts. These hyenas want to chase them away. Oh, there's another one incoming. There's another two incoming. Oh, no, those are. No, there's vultures coming. Oh, hyenas, you're going to have your work cut out for you now. It's just got warm enough. Vultures settling off in the dead trees to wait. Now, as the white-backed vultures have arrived as well, hyena really do have their work cut out for them, and they've decided, oh no, don't go all the way over there. That's interesting. That's very clever. I wonder if that hyena is not going to drag the carcass to the car in the hope that the vehicle will deter the vultures. Possible. Oh. Let's see where they're going to go. I think that's exactly what he's done. I think they've dropped it close to behind that vehicle. He's going right into the thick bushes, maybe not so inexperienced. Unfortunately, that hyena has just taken the kill right away from where we can see them. So behind that thick clump of gwari bushes, in the hope of deterring the scavenging vultures. However, they have been spotted. Ooh! Dive bombed by vultures now. Oh, turn the tables. Now they've got their work cut out for them. It's just this is our best position for now, unfortunately, but we might be able to watch some of the action happening. The vultures smell blood, metaphorically. They've realized that these young hyenas don't fully know what they're doing. They're outnumbered. And it's in fact the hooded vultures that are causing most of the fuss. I think they've been seen off for now, but it is only a matter of time before the vulture numbers, well, first of all, until it heats up sufficiently that the vultures have enough warmth and energy to be able to start to arrive in numbers, and then they will chase those two hyena away unless more reinforcements arrive. Now it's interesting to see the two of them feeding on the scraps, and that brings us back to Sean's question, shivering my way through the morning. Sean was wondering, because the hyenas in a hyena clan, the highest ranking hyenas will always eat first. And Sean was wondering, does that mean that some of the others sort of might go hungry since they haven't managed to eat their fill? Sometimes, if the carcass is too small and the dominant females are there, they will eat their fill first to the point of bursting, and then the other hyenas will be allowed to come in. Generally, although the higher ranking females do get the sort of the best feeding rights and the best position, they will tolerate other hyenas coming in to nibble around once they've eaten a little bit. So they're not completely exclusive, you know, they won't exclude all of the hyenas completely the entire time. Just initially in the beginning they'll show quite a great deal of aggression. Oh, it's such a pity that hyena dragged that carcass that way and not this way, because unfortunately they have gone completely out of our view now. I can't see them anywhere. If I were them, I guess that's what I would have done too. I guess I would have dragged the carcass out of harm's way. Let's just have a look at these vultures here, since we have got a beautiful scene in this morning light. Now, I had a giggle earlier, and unfortunately, it was out of where Dave could show it to you. I said that it was cold and that the vultures are struggling. Now, when these two vultures descended to this dead tree, these two white-backed vultures, there was actually a third. However, the third completely missed its landing, tried to land on a branch that was too thin, and promptly dropped out of the tree and sort of disappeared out of view. So there was a third. I'm having a giggle because it's absolutely fine, just by the way. I know where it is. It's moved off to a tree a little bit further away, but perhaps not entirely with its dignity intact. Just like the jackals, vultures playing a waiting game, a game of patience. And I think that ends our scene of the different scavengers of Juma. In the meantime, on this chilly morning, Brent has got a surprise animal outside of its natural environment.
So there we go, big hippo bull. You see him defecating, wagging his tail against that buffalo thorn. Look at the steam coming off him. Now, I've noticed this quite a bit with this particular bull. He's leaving the Buffalo's waterhole, and he goes and sleeps in the drainage system, or little creek system, behind the dam. Now, he's a particularly grumpy individual, so we're not going to go any closer to him. He'll probably move back into the water at some point during the day when it's a bit warmer. And off he goes. Well, anyway, nice to see a hippo out of the water, and you can see what massive animals they actually are. So we don't have too many hippos in this area. We are quite far from the river. So always nice to catch one, and we catch one out of the water. So we are around the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. We unfortunately had no luck with any sign of tracks around the southern area, so we're in the sort of northeast at the moment, zigzagging our way through the bush. Oh, morning guys, they're looking quite sprightly this morning. Crested Franklin. Now, there's certain members of our staff who are not the best morning people. And every now and then we do get a morning off. And one particular person really complains about the Franklins and the Babblers. And that is Geraldine. The Franklins generally wake up at about 5, 5.15. They first start calling sometimes. Oh.
Just involved here at the junction of the amenities. I'm going to check sanitation towards the parapet.
So I just got a report from Aubrey, who's Juma's guide out of Gallagher, that he heard some kudu alarm calling. Actually, right in that area we were earlier this morning. So we are going to start slowly moving our way back there. Sorry, I need to listen. Okay. So it sounds like the Zoe's Road at the junction with Philemon's cut line. So that's probably about 900 meters from where we started off this morning. So a little bit further to the west. So we are going to slowly meander back in that direction. It sounds like you've been having the an absolutely phenomenal time with Jamie and three different predators at one sighting. Black-back jackal, side-striped jackal and hyena. That's incredible. I'm quite jealous. And being able to sit still in the cold, Jandre and I, of course, have been marching on.
There's only some of you see stuff to kill now on the city dam.
Okay, tell me the music.
Okay. So this is the area where we lost that male leopard's tracks yesterday. I'm wondering if he didn't do a strange maneuver. Now, I do apologize, we might get a little bit of signal breakup down in this dip, but I just want to check for tracks very quickly.
Daisy, it seems as though Brent's signal just couldn't quite handle that trip through the dip. I was on my way to the hyena den just to kind of get an idea as to what was happening there, finish off and round off our story quite nicely. However, I've just heard reports on the Game Drive channel that the hyena den is not active. In other words, the little ones are all safely tucked away in bed. And the moms are out, quite possibly just on the other side of the dam, if I had to guess, probably sleeping off some very round bellies after an enormous meal. That's where the hyenas, I suspect, might be. And so we're going to start heading east into the rising sun and across towards Chinta Plains. There we go. Sorry guys, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. It seems as though my quest towards a Cheetah Plains may well be a good plan because they've just found a leopard in the drainage line around the lodge of Cheetah Plains. So that's where we'll be heading. Fingers crossed, everyone, that we have a signal there and that we'll be able to see her. I think that we're going to head across in that direction. Yay, it's very exciting times. Mike, I copied your message. I'm also interested. Mike, sorry, can you just reconfirm the lock of that sighting? Copy that, thank you. I'm on Biffleswick cut line now, so I'm still far, but I'll switch to Eastern Channel when I get a bit closer. Yay! We've got a place for that sighting. Admittedly, we've got a place to number three to wait for that sighting, but that's okay because we're still quite a significant difference away. So Dave, we're gone from sitting still in the rising sun, and now we've got to race across, shivering our way every step of the way.
A leopard makes it worth it,
as Brent said. It can handle the cold if you've got the cats to make up for it. So we're not going to race there. We're going to try and strike a balance between racing and not having to wait around. Where's that Dacre gone? Just saw it dive in through here. Nope. He's disappeared. Just some distant impala. I wonder which leopard it is. I don't know. It sounded like Mike said it was a she, so it could be in Kanyeni, it could be Tundi in that area. It could be either of those leopards. We will just have to wait until we get there to find out. And I haven't seen in Kanyeni, so I'm very excited. I've heard so many stories. Dave, of course, has seen her. Oh. Every time we go down into a dip, it drops by about 5 degrees. Then you start to warm up as you go up the slopes. I'm also checking very carefully along this road for the lion tracks because we don't know where those lions have gone. So far, they haven't popped out onto this road. I suspect that they may have gone further into Manuleti. So to the north of where we last saw them, away from our traverse area. And then we know the Unkahumas very often move into Manuleti itself, around that top northwestern corner. Or there's a chance that they've headed west into a property called Simbambili. I spoke this morning a bit about the lion dynamics and the fact that they are changing so much. We were discussing it with Tristan and Doug yesterday, or last night. Brent and I were highly social. We had friends over, and we promptly both fell asleep on the couch trying to chat to them. So, you know, we did really well there on our crazy wild Saturday night. But before we fell asleep, we were chatting a little bit about the lion dynamics and the changes that are happening here. And the fact that the Matimbas have been mysteriously entering Simbambili out of nowhere and then walking all the way back south in a morning back towards Londolozi. Now the Matimba males were the coalition that were dominant in this area before the Birmingham boys kicked them out. I don't quite know what it is that has prompted this shift in dynamics. Alright, something's telling me to stop. Something in the back of my mind spotted something. Ah, that's what I've seen. There's lion tracks in the road. It'll be tricky for me to show them to you, but I'm going to try. But I'm not going to stop for too long. You see them right in the middle there, Dave.
Yep.
Immediately my mind went to lion, just judging by the size. Perfect, thank you, Dave. I'm not going to jump out of the car and show you them in great detail just because I do want to keep moving. We've got at least one female walking down this road. It looks as though there's more than one though, because if we check a little bit further to the left, unfortunately underneath car tracks, there are more. So the prides walk down here. I'm trying to see carefully if there's a male track. These are female tracks. I don't see any male tracks. All right. So this is where the lions went last night. Whether or not Junior is with them is a different question. We're going to call these in, we're going to follow up while we can, and we're going to head to Cheetah Plains all in one, and I'm going to send you back to Brent.
Welcome back. We've crossed the Mwati River and are now heading into that area where the kudu alarm calls were heard. And Jamie's on her way down to Cheetah Plains. So, exciting morning. I love this. When there's alarm calls about, that means there's cats about. So we're going to go check back towards the treehouse waterhole in case whatever was there starts coming to the east. And it's still really chilly. I'll just check with Aubrey where he'd like me to check. Aubrey. We might be off the vehicle on foot tracking. So what we're going to do is we're going to head along through here, sort of to the northern side of this little river system that comes from the treehouse waterhole. So we've already checked the southern side earlier this morning, but we didn't check the northern side, so fingers crossed that north is our lucky direction today. Slowly now, just check very, very carefully. And this is just gorgeous. There's a little bit of mist around. The light is probably going to burn it off quite quickly as the sun gets higher over the horizon and warm us up a little bit. So as we were talking, leopards really like sort of little dry creek beds or river beds.
Jamie.
Nice trees around. Standing by.
Yeah, Brent, on Sandy Patch, just south of the power line there, was a track mark on the trailer there. We landed this track mark. There's a mother that been bumped by Ingrid, looks like last night, but just eaten little bit at the back, but no sign of that Ingwe. Looks like she just hit it last night and she didn't come back here, but there's still my Mingi Yama here.
Sorry, guys. Copy tax, is that Pezul Insignia?
Negative, just on the ground.
Maybe she went to fetch my Bimban.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, very interesting news there. So Taxon's found an impala that's been killed by a leopard, but it's been fed on very little and then abandoned.
Great.
Maybe not abandoned.
Who lost tracks for Kibana yesterday?
1 second, sorry. Jamie, they were in the block between Buffalo's Hook and Hyena Road.
Copy, there's incomes of form,
a daughter
Ingwe going west on Buffalo's Hook cut line and then cutting south into the Mwati around Barry
Cutline. Copy, thanks. So, male leopard tracks, female leopard tracks, dead impala, but no leopard! I think we're going to go try have a look at that carcass.
Oh, yeah.
See what's happening there.
Yeah, you're on south of the corner towards the color plane, but just a mile and all south of the plane.
Morning, Kyle. Kyle says, well, since Tigana hasn't been around Juma that often recently, wouldn't this make it a prime opportunity for another male to come in? Well, he has, Kyle. He's been on Juma a lot, except he just seems to walk through overnight. So just in between the live safaris, he cruises through, particularly on the northern side of the property. He came in through the south last time, so he has been there. So I don't think there's any real chance of another male trying to take over his core part territory on Juma just yet. So very interesting. So where Taxans found that impala kill, it could be very easily Karula. It could also very easily be Shadow in that area. That'll be very fascinating to see if either of them bring their cubs back to their kill. It's possible they might have left the kill, eaten a little bit, left the kill, and returned to go fetch the cubs. So, fingers crossed. So I'm gonna go check back towards Philemon's cut line and up towards Zoe's Road. Now, the kill hasn't been hoisted, which is a bit of a problem, but looks like the hyenas are preoccupied with that buffalo carcass, so they're not going to get hold of that impala just yet.
Jamie, I've just got to fit two vehicles in here myself in Andres. It looks like it's a big squeeze. The second vehicle won't be able to leave them, so I'll just make one vehicle at a time. I've moved out for Andres, so... Yeah, maybe contact Andres
when you're in the east,
and you'll make
some space for you.
Okay. Copy
that, thanks, Mike.
Okay. So there we go, just a little update from Jamie. Those lion tracks she was looking at have gone north into Buffalo's Hook. And the only lion track we had this morning went east into Torchwood. So, but it does look like there's some leopards around, so fingers crossed. So this is the area where Aubrey said he heard those kudu alarming, and the kill's over there. So maybe it's the leopard heading back to fetch the little ones. Morning, Bud, in North Carolina. Bud's asking an interesting question, saying which animals take an active role in raising and protecting their offspring? Well, you can't look at it from a human point of view, because it's a very different thing. So even though male leopards have very little to do with the cubs, their active part in raising and protecting the offspring is protecting their territory from other male leopards, because another male leopard would immediately come in and kill those cubs, and to make sure the female comes into estrus again. Oh, there's Orbs. I'm just gonna say good morning, Bud. I will carry on with your question in a second. Oh, hey. Any luck? Maybe I found me to fetch my pimpan. Did you hear a taxi got near my that side?
Yeah, but you say Buga does not just hide for us, he doesn't like to tell us. So.
Oh my ganga.
Yeah.
Yo. Paisan.
He doesn't catch anything. Nothing.
Okay, I'm going to keep checking this area, but I think maybe she went south to fetch my pimpan.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm going to go check the boundary. Okay. Cheers, Orbs. Bye, guys. Enjoy. Don't look so cold. The sun's coming. Africa. There's some very cold people on that back of that vehicle. Blankets up to here. Okay. So Aubrey and I are in agreement that we think that Leopard's gone to fetch cubs, possibly, and left the kill that side. So fingers crossed. So there's a possibility we might not see any sign of them this morning on the sunrise safari, but there's a really good chance on the sunset safari if hyenas or Tingana don't find that kill during the day. So we're chatting about parental duties in animals. So, and as I was saying, the same pretty much works for lions. So the male lions don't have a real active role in rearing the cubs, but their role is to protect the area that the cubs grow up in. Oh, hello. Some elephants. Yes, you're very scary. So elephants is another one. The females will take a much more active role in rearing the young than the males. The males just mate and move out. So you heard a bunch of beeps. It was just us putting on that little virtual reality rig on the front of the vehicle. So I'm just gonna clap quickly. Say when, Jandre. So Andre is making me hold my hands in the air for fun. At least I get to wiggle them warm.
And wiggle away. One more louder.
Okay, so with a nice breeding herd of elephant, it also gives us a chance to sit quietly and we might, oh yes, look at that head shake. We might get a chance to hear some alarm calls while we're sitting here. So at the moment, most of the elephants are off to our left. And it looks like quite a few of them are about to come through. So if we sit quietly here, we should get engulfed. But this little creature over here is, might come quite close to the vehicle. These young ones tend to become a little bit curious sometimes. You can see at the moment, far more interested in feeding though. Oh, there we go. Yes, you're very big and scary. This is very typical young elephant behavior. And that's more curious than anything else. Look, this isn't this exquisite. Hey, little one. Yes, we're very scared of you. So far, it's not displaying any aggression, more curiosity. See, there we go. And, well, I thought it was going to give a head shake, but decided there was something to eat. Here it comes. Yes. Silly. And now I'm just going to eat that bush willow. There are some more coming. Oh! Naughty! Did it get it throwing the thing at us? Naughty elephant! How dare you throw a branch at me? Did you see that? That naughty little elephant threw a branch at us. There we go. So it's a juvenile. It's about 8.
Sorry, Brent, one cut out.
Oh, it seems like we're having some technical difficulties with the VR rig. There must be really small gremlins to climb inside that one. Sorry about this, guys.
Go for it.
Okay, so this very cute little Eddie, a little bit cheeky, threw a little branch at us just now, and likes to shake its head, kick some dust in our general direction. Probably about 8-9 years old. Here we go, it's gonna... wonderful display. That display was twofold, it also gave it a chance to get to any plants that might be underneath that fallen branch. The rest of the herd coming through. There's a nice young bull coming now on the other side. Look at that, standing on the... So this is all very much displaying just for us. My car's using its foot there. Now, not really feeling, as I said, it's far more displaying for us at the moment. Oh, got a nice little push from under there as well. Here comes.
Let's clap again. Sorry.
Sorry about this, guys. Here we go. Oh, are we going to get another little, how are you doing? You can see the rest of the herd moving off behind this little Ellie, who's right next to us. Oh, hello, Mom. Hello, Mom. It's okay. It's okay. No need to be upset. There we go. Good girl. So we can see her there. She's not 100% comfortable. You see her ears are out like that. But we are getting a lot of elephants that aren't used to vehicles at the moment that have moved in from the western areas of the Kruger National Park due to the water in the Sabi Sands. So we're just always a little bit cautious. And you can see that female wasn't 100% relaxed, so we're not going to continue on with this herd. She's still watching us very carefully. I've got to watch the elephant. And she, just the way she's behaving makes me not want to take her eyes off her. She did look like she was about to sneak around. Okay, she's calmed down now. So, yeah, see, sometimes Eddies do this and they like to charge you from behind. That's why I'm watching her very carefully. But if we moved right now, it could actually become a problem. She might chase the vehicle. So I'm trying to keep still. And she's being very naughty. I know elephants that do this and then chase the vehicle from behind. Just keeping an extra eye on her. Okay, now she's got her back to us. We're going to take that opportunity to move out of here. I'm just going to keep my eyes on her while we're going out. Okay, all fine. So, again, just that little bit of behavior, and that was a little bit extra. She seemed just a little bit too upset too quickly with nothing happening. So, don't want to put any more pressure on that herd. We had a lovely view of the little one playing with us. So we just decided to leave. Okay. I just need to check what was happening while my radio was down. Klumbevind Lov, Philemon's Cutline Junction Zoes. Okay, so we're now looking to see if there's either leopard tracks coming in or out. Either or could be positive. So this is the southern edge of our traverse area. So what we're looking for is leopard tracks either going in or out. Oh, the next morning meeting. Even the man from the Free State's cold today.
Like two jackets on.
Two jackets. How are you, Pete?
Black and new.
Nice to see you.
Moi, man.
Anything in the west?
Skunk Island's going to cross shortly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, half month's drift, so it might be closer to Shelly side.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to stress. Okay, cool.
You better go.
I'm looking. We've got alarm calls in this area, so we're just checking around. Jamie's already on her way there.
Okay. Yeah. Cool. Well, hello.
Oh, there's some serious traffic jams going on here. There's about five vehicles. Yeah. Cool. Enjoy, guys. Yeah, enjoy. Good luck. This is a serious traffic jam. We've got about six vehicles. This is Elvis. Morning, Elvis. Hiya, Paul. I'm getting. Oh, we're out of here. I'm done with traffic. I don't like traffic. Let's just go through the bush. No, I'm joking. I'm joking. We'll stick to the road. But we are looping around. So there's a report of a cheetah that all those vehicles are rushing to. But it is unfortunately outside of our Travis Zern. So we're not going to rush. We're going to keep working this area for leopard. There we go, update from Andrew. He's with that Inkahuma lioness who's got those three wonderful little cubs on Torchwood when she's denning, and it sounds like she's heading back towards that den now. I can't wait for those cubs to get a little bit bigger and start meandering across onto Juma. So, good morning, Davina in Illinois. So, Davina's wondering about this thing. Let's wait, there we go, that thing that I was clapping at. It's called a virtual reality rig, I think. Jandre will explain better than I can, but I will try. So, basically, it's a ball of GoPros. So, it shoots a 360-degree video. And if you have a smartphone or tablet or what's it called, Jandre?
Oculus Rift.
Oculus Rift. See, I can use technical terms too. You are able to have a 360-degree view around you. So we've got one out already. It's called, I think, the Naughty Elephant. And if you search on YouTube on the Safari Live channel, I think, or one of the, I don't know. I'm not very good at this stuff. I probably should get a bit better. So no, I think it's on the Safari Live account, and look up the Naughty Elephant. And if you've got a device like this, you can look what's in the sky, you can look what's behind you, and swing it around. So definitely worth having a look. We're trying to make a few more of those. So that's why I was clapping at the ball of GoPros, Davina. Okay, so as I was going to say, no sign of any tracks. I think I spotted a baboon track. and more elephants. And some thickets here. Hey, little mister. Unfortunately, they aren't quite, not the best area to view. Let's leave this little group of elephants. They're still across our southern boundary. And see what else we can find. I'm going to do another loop through this area. I might head back to where that carcass is so we can have a quick look at it. You don't want to spend too much time around the carcass when an animal's not there. But in this area, normally not too much of a problem during the day. We don't do it at night if it's on the ground. Oh, elephants everywhere. Little babies just back here. How's that, Jandre? Oh, vroom, to you too. Watch out, little baby, you'll get a tree on your head. There you go, why thank you. Opening up a nice window for us to look at her by pushing down the tree in front of her. Wow, there are so many elephants around at the moment. I'm guessing, oh, there's a little one popping through. I'm guessing in this group, which is probably connected to that group we've just seen, I'm going to guess there's probably 100 plus elephants in this area at the moment. Oh, look at that. Balancing its foot on a dead stick there. Playing with a single piece of grass. All it managed to pick up with its not too coordinated trunk. Dropped it. Let's find another one. So it takes elephants a little while to really master the use of that long nose of theirs, and you often watch the babies. Oh, he did well there. Well done, little man. Got some leaves. But at this age, they rely mostly on mother's milk. It's quite funny when they get frustrated with their trunks and they can't make it do what they want it to do. They start shaking their heads at their own noses. And you hear all the others behind breaking branches. There's even smaller baby popping out. Back to the same little branch it was arguing with earlier. There's a nice big female quite close to us up front, and she's just lifted a whole dead tree to get to the grass that's growing underneath. And what's going to surprise you about this grass, if we have a look, there's some of it there, but the long grass underneath, it's all green. Isn't that incredible? In this drought, there is green grass. And there's a reason for this. We're on the top end of a seep line, so there's underground water that moves through here, and that's what she's taking advantage of there. Hey, big lady. Aren't you a clever one? There we go. You can see she's moved this big thorny thing here, and that was keeping the grass protected from other animals. So she's moved it out of the way to get to this last bit of green panicum. Look at that. There we go. Nice green panicum grass. Oop. Quick dust off. And down the gullet. Oh. Looks like she didn't dust that one off fast enough. Putting her head right into the thorns. Listen to that. So Sandy's wondering whether elephants will eat berries too, not just leaves and grass. Most definitely, Sandy, but not too many berries around at this time of the year. Exhausted the grass now. Looks like she was thinking about eating some buffalo thorn. I think she might find a bit more. searching for that nice juicy bit of grass. Justin in Idaho is wondering, why do elephants push down trees? Is it for entertainment or is it to get to the other leaves? It is for feeding, it's not for entertainment. Sometimes you might find a bull and might move around and play a bit with the tree, but to push it down will generally be for feeding. Watch this. See how she's moving that thorny thing to get to the green stuff underneath. And she's found a wild asparagus. And down the gullet, the wild asparagus went. Oh, she found another bigger wild asparagus. Yes, shake your head. Very normal elephant behavior. Well, she's gonna move off. I'm gonna do the same and keep searching for whatever. Oh, I know, just impala. Those kudu might have been alarming at. Genre, eyes up, let's find a kitty cat. Now, when I'm in this area, I'm always keeping an eye out for Nelson. That's not Nelson, but a male impala. If you're an impala, you have to be alert because lots of different things want to eat you. But he's got a bit of help at the moment. And just off to the right in the dead tree there is an oxpecker who's warming himself before probably going to get onto that impala to feed. And they do work as early warning systems for a lot of the animals and will alarm call if they see a predator. Two, an adult and a juvenile. Sorry guys, I have to keep a close ear on the radio. So Aubrey, Herbert and myself are all checking this area and so far no luck, but we will keep checking. Good morning, Brenda in Virginia. Brenda has asked me a relatively sad question. Is it true that a whole pack of wild dogs was wiped out by illness? It is true. The Lower Sabi pack, there were 17 dogs. The very sad thing, the alpha female was pregnant, and on autopsy she had 18 puppies inside her. So very, very sad. And the disease that wiped them out was canine distemper. And that is generally passed on by domestic dogs when they move into wild areas. And it is a very, very sad thing. I know the Kruger has started a big inoculation process to the rest of the remaining dogs. Now, because dogs are such social animals, those diseases like distemper and rabies spread incredibly quickly throughout the whole pack. So if one gets it, it's pretty much a death sentence for everyone. But Sandy says, what is the concern that it might spread to other species in the park? Oh, Sandy, it's going to stay with the canines. It's canine distemper. It doesn't mutate into anything that the cats and other animals can get. So jackals and dogs are the only ones who really are at threat from distemper or canine distemper. But it is a very, very sad thing. I actually knew about it before the press release and stuff was done. And very, very sad. And I know the National Parks and Endangered Wildlife Trust are working to try and inoculate as many dogs in that area as possible. So we're heading back up Philemon's cut line, trying to see what's here. And so far, no sign of whatever scared those kudu. So I'm going to head a little bit further to the north again and try and have a look around Zoe's Road. Almost not a cloud in the sky. A beautiful winter's day. And don't forget, there's fireside chat this evening. And we'll have quite a bit to chat about, including the first ever pangolin on Safari Live. So we're going to go check back towards where Taxon had that impala carcass. Maybe we'll have some luck that something's moved onto there since he's been gone. And maybe we might find another leopard and cubs. Seems like there's quite a lot going on this morning.
I'll stand by, could be.
I'm just going to park us with this wonderful view over the western sectors of the Sabi Sands. I'm going to go just jump on my radio and check what's happening on Arethusa. Look at that, isn't that beautiful? Lovely morning light. We're looking west. Morning, mobile stations. Can I have an update for Safari and Dow, please?
Station on the fence line, please. Parai, is that your visual? Station's here on the fence.
Yeah, just wait.
Wait, no zones this area. Go around.
Very, very beautiful morning here in the Lowveld. Unfortunately, the kitty cats are being a little bit difficult at the moment, but we've had some lovely elephant sightings, and hoping either on the rest of the sunrise safari or the sunset safari to find you guys one of Africa's big cats. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to stop again at one of my favourite spots, sort of a viewing spot, and look out over the east. And we've looked to the west, now let's go have a look at the east. Still looking for lion or leopard tracks. Unfortunately, the lion tracks crossed into Buffalo's Hook. We haven't got any leopard tracks just yet. But Jamie had Tingana tracks heading towards the Mawati, so we'll maybe do a loop down there a little later. So we're on Juma Private Game Reserve. We're now going to jump across to Jamie, who's in the far east. So on Cheetah Plains Private Game Reserve, let's go see what.
I am so sorry about that. Dave and I are devastated. I broke my left and front. I found you the leopard, but unfortunately our signal just didn't quite extend to into that ditch. We tried so hard to get you a view of her. She's killed a bushbuck right outside one of the guests' rooms in Cheetah Plains. So, I mean, they're going to have the most spectacular view when they come back from their game drive this morning. But she was busy feeding, and in fact, when we first arrived, it was quite a tricky spot to navigate. She's tucked into a drainage line or a river system. And we drove in, and I could not, for the life of me, see the leopard until all of a sudden we noticed a bush that was moving. And she was, there's a gap of about 6 feet between the top of where we were sitting and where she is at the bottom of that river system. But she was looking right up at us, and I suddenly realized, you know, we didn't know exactly where she was. We were parked basically on top of her. We didn't mean to be. It was just that was where the off-road tracks went, and she'd obviously moved and dragged her carcass while we were entering that sighting. She'd obviously dragged it underneath an overhang in the drainage line. So there was sort of a moment where we stared into each other's eyes, and I just sort of very carefully backed away as much as I could. I'm very sorry that we cannot bring you a picture from that particular area. Unfortunately, it's just impossible for us to have a signal everywhere. What I tried to do, actually, is I tried to take, in true James's style, I tried to take a picular video of her, and I'll show you the end result, but you're all going to laugh at me because I was so cold that I couldn't hold anything still because we raced through here in the chilly morning air, and I couldn't quite get the camera or the binoculars to hold still, no matter how much I tried to rest them on something. So when we go into the shade here, I'll show you, just to prove that we did see a leopard. But it's okay because Dave was there. Dave saw the leopard too. Dave saw the leopard too. She is very full-bellied and very happy looking. It was in Kanyeni. Let me try and show you my terrible, terrible picula. James would be ashamed of me. There you go. See, look, there's a leopard there. Yes, Jamie did really well. Really very well. I should be a camera woman. Best filming of a leopard anywhere ever. I was cold, in my defense, although Dave's sitting there going, yeah, tell me about it.
Yeah,
okay, thank you, Dave. Dave's got a tripod. So I'm sorry, I couldn't even film for that long because we had to race back out again when we realized that the signal wasn't going to come up and work. You didn't want to disappear off your screens for too long, so I couldn't even stay and sort of try and get you some background footage or something. So, in Kanyeni is there. We broke my leopard drought, unfortunately, minus all of our passengers on the back. Next time, guys, next time. And it's a tiny kill, it's a baby bushbuck. So there's always a chance. There is always that chance that she will be back out again. She might even go and fetch her cubs at some point. So we're going to hang around in the hope that she does decide to do that. I don't know where she stashed her cubs. They weren't in that sighting with her. And we'll hang out here and see if she doesn't decide to head out and go and fetch them and take them back to that kill. And then maybe we'll have a sighting with her en route. It seems as though the female leopards have been successful last night in their hunting endeavors. I'm sure Brent's been telling you about the fact that Taxon tracked down and found a carcass of an impala that is currently basically still completely intact, and that they suspect might be because the leopard concerned, the female leopard concerned, has gone off to fetch her babies on Juma. So we've got leopards all over the show. Unfortunately, I just couldn't quite show you. Inkanyeni sitting in the bottom of the drainage line, panting away, as predators do when they gorge themselves on the meat that they're eating. Although I certainly wouldn't mind sharing some of that warmth now, because it is really chilly racing across to her, only to be devastated that we couldn't actually view her. Oh well, next time. Next time, there are plenty more leopards where that came from, or something. You know what I mean. Now, what we shall do is we'll head across to the open area on Cheetah Plains and see if we can't spot Cheetah, have a different spotted cat, plus keep an eye. We're going to keep circling where we know we have signal. We'll keep circling the area where she has her kill. It must be so exciting if you're a guest at Cheetah Plains. Imagine sticking your head out, having your morning coffee on your balcony, and there's a leopard right underneath the room, munching away on a bushbuck. It's going to be less fortunate in 2 days' time, of course, unless the hyenas come and collect it for them, move it away. Otherwise, they're going to start to experience the certain odor that comes with a couple of day old kill. We've spoken a bit about Cheetah Plains, and we have Mike to thank for that leopard sighting. Oh, we had some canaries there that were busy pecking around the buffalo skull. Where have they gone? Have they got them there, Dave? Or they disappeared? Oh, there they are at the back. Sweet little birds pecking away at the grass seeds. don't often see them on Juma's side, at least not for an extended period of time. Look at that beautiful yellow face. They're the same family, or at least related to the finches and the waxbills. The canaries and the weavers are all very, very similar in structure. Those tiny little bills that are really built solely for picking up grass seeds and other small vegetable matter. Totally different to the much more robust beaks of the things like lilac-breasted rollers. Very rapid moving birds. Now that looks like the male. There were a couple of them fluttering about, male and a couple of females, but I've lost track of where the females are. And as with most of the bird species, the male taking on a slightly bigger, sort of brighter coloration pattern. And in case you're wondering why your picture's wobbling, it's the heat coming off Rusty's engine. Of heat waves. I almost want to lie on the bonnet for a little while and thaw. At least we've got the sun now. We're going to stay with this little bird as long as possible. Use it to warm ourselves up. He heard me. He didn't like the sound of that at all. Realized that we were using him for other purposes and off he disappeared. And before I got distracted by the little birds hopping about, Stay Lodge, I was about to get to your question as to whether or not each lodge has a head guide or if that is the landowner. So yes, every lodge will have a head guide. Our situation is a little bit different just because we don't have guests necessarily. I mean, I think we definitely call Steph our head guide as our operations manager, but it's our situation is a little bit abnormal. Outside of the norm of a typical guiding team. But a guiding team will have a head ranger, and the head ranger is a crucial role, because what they will do is they will be in charge, first of all, of the discipline of the guides, the ethics, the way in which the guides approach animals, approach sightings, drive off-road, and so on. They also act as mediators between the guiding team and the management team. They'll act as the go-betweens. If, for example, in the very rare situation where one guide wants to lay a complaint against another for something, or not even necessarily a complaint, just a chat about the way in which things have occurred out in the field, then the head guide plays a very, very important role in that sense. But most importantly, they will be the mentors for new guides that have started out. Particularly with young guiding teams, they can step in and just provide some experience. So it will almost inevitably be one of the most experienced guides on that particular guiding team. And then you'll have your senior guides and your junior guides and then trainees. And it's an interesting thing becoming a guide, because of course learning the animals and the bush and all kinds of things is the most important aspect, but there's a great deal more that goes into being a guide and guiding guests. For example, dealing with people, dealing with different guests from around the world, hosting dinners. There's a whole range of different things that go into as part of learning to be a guide, and you do have to learn. I mean, I've met some people who just have people skills, and they automatically fall into that role of being a host. But for some people, it's not always that easy. For that different personality types, I personally know that I've had to learn a great deal about dealing with anything from guests' complaints to people being sick or ill or injured in any way. There's so many different scenarios that arise out here, but the wonderful thing about that is that not only are we fortunate enough to live out here in the bush with all of its wonderful animals and wonderful things, but we've also get to experience and meet different people from across the globe. And the same applies to our live safaris. We might not have you physically on the back of the vehicle, but we're still having a conversation. And we still get to share in the excitement of your excitement of seeing things that we might have seen before, but we always see through fresh eyes, both through the camera and from people who are experiencing it for the very first time. Oh, and just by the way, quick update on those lion tracks that I was chatting about the last time you saw me on Buffalo's Hook Cutline. Those tracks went north into Buffalo's Hook itself. I think probably Brent gave you that update about the lion in Torchwood, the lioness, the mother of those brand new cubs. Andrew saw her but left her to allow her to go back to the den site without being accompanied by a vehicle. Obviously, she's got to be treated with a great deal of respect at the moment. So the Wanukum is still around about the first rock. A very warm welcome to Edmund, who's watching in Australia, speaking of viewers across the globe. Now, Edmund was wondering what big cat has the largest range and how far that will extend. And we're going to have to do a bit of navigating here. Look, it's my nemesis tree. It's a silver cluster leaf tree that's in my way. It's blocking my path. I'm not even going to think about trying to move that. It's a little bit big and a little bit still attached to the rest of the trunk. So Edmund, in terms of, yes, we made it. In terms of the cat with the largest range, the big cat, is the one that I'm actually kind of hoping we're going to see out on the plains of Cheetah Plains, and that is the cheetah itself. Now a cheetah has, like an Austin Powers style turn here, knocked our antenna over in that whole process. The cheetah has the largest home range, and particularly a female cheetah. The female cheetah in certain areas have such enormous home ranges so as almost to be considered to be nomadic. In other words, not having a particular home range. We've got the largest metapopulation of cheetah in Africa, in the Kruger National Park, which is where we are now. But the boys that we see, the cheetah boys that we see, move all the way from right down south in Malamala up about 50 kilometers, no, exaggeration, 30 kilometers up in a straight line to Manuleti, which is the property all the way to the north of us, which gives them a territory, because they are males and therefore they have a specific area that they like to frequent. Of, I would guess, somewhere in the region of close to 4,000, maybe even more, hectares, 4,000 football fields. The females will just keep moving. They'll have enormous, up to 25,000 hectares or more of home range. Arriving at Cheetah Plains Pan. Let us stop and do a quick scan. Just want to make sure there's no, on the subject of cheetah, that there's no cheetah hiding somewhere in the shadows. Brent apparently was tracking a female cheetah the other day on Cheetah Plains. So you never know. At the moment though, it just looks like some very cold lapwings. And that is that. Less animals in this winter time desperately racing to go and have a drink. They're not using up as much water as they would during the hot summer months. just moving my vehicle off the road so that I can check properly for tracks. I unfortunately, not being 6'4", like Brent, I actually can't see over that side of the vehicle at all, despite the fact that I now have three blankets rolled up that I'm sitting on. They don't really make Land Rovers for tiny people, and they don't really make them for people of Brent's size either. We need a happy medium somewhere in between. We've got interesting times here with our leopardesses. We had Inkanyeni on a kill just outside the Cheetah Plains Lodge, and now Brent has a kill, but apparently no leopard.
So we've come to check on this impala carcass that Taxon found a little earlier. And as we can see, it's barely been touched. And he said it was killed by a leopard. No sign of the leopard, but if it was one of the females, she might have returned to fetch her cubs before coming back. I've got a feeling it could be shadow in the area we're in. And she's slightly fed off on the rump there at the bottom. You can see she's eaten a little bit there. Very, very little though. I just want to see if I can find any tracks around here. So I'm sure Taxi's right, but I mean, just the way it is and the way it's been fed on, for me, almost says cheetah. So starting at the rump, not opening the stomach, but you never know, sometimes animals do strange things. And I will try to see if I can see a track to confirm. But definitely going to be worth coming to check here. I think we're probably going to leave it for the rest of the morning and check again on the sunset safari. Just going to have a quick little dabble around. Might be sleeping somewhere. Not too far from the carcass, so just going to look a little bit around the back there. I think it is. Okay, it's definitely a leopard. Female leopard. So there's a carcass here, so I'm not going to get off the vehicle and follow these tracks. She will come back. Maybe it could be. Let me just have a quick look at this track again. I'm going to try and get a spot where you guys can see it as well. A little bit too close to me, Jean-André. You see the track? Look where we're looking, a little bit to the side. Sort of in line with that. There we go. There we go. There it is there. So definitely a leopard track. Maybe a young male. Interesting, very interesting. So we're not sure who or what or which leopard might have killed this. It could be a female, or maybe a young male. No, I think that's a female track. But we're definitely going to come back here this evening to have a look. I don't want to spend too much time in case it's a new leopard that's unrelaxed, and I'd rather let them get settled on the carcass before we go bashing around. The other thing is, those tracks are heading south from here. So it could be Karuna, maybe, even going back to fetch her little ones. So, nice spot to leave the carcass. Very little chance that vultures are going to find it under this platform. You can see very, very well camouflaged. Well, very interesting, very interesting. A mystery to ponder during the daylight hours for us. And hopefully the answer shall be revealed on the sunset safari. I'm still just sort of trying to figure out what's going on, but very exciting. A very good chance that we're going to have a cat on the sunset safari. And I know you had a very brief visual of Nkanyin earlier. So this is how the guys found that impala carcass. You can see there's a nice big drag mark there, and they would have followed that drag mark on foot till they found that impala. Now, when we find drag marks, it is very exciting. You've always got a much better chance of being able to find an animal when you know they've got a kill, because they're going to be coming back to that area. They're going to be more stationary in that area. The only negative is that we're not that far from where the hyenas like to hang out, but hopefully the hyenas are going to be sidetracked by that buffalo they stole from the lions. Kathy from Melbourne's got a very interesting question. She says, why do animals not bleed out when they're killed? Could it be a shock factor? So humans tend to bleed out. Well, with humans, we tend to put holes in each other, and that tends to cause a lot of blood loss. So a big cat normally uses a suffocation grip to kill their prey, and there is very little chance of blood during that grip. So what happens, and I'm going to show you an image here of what a big cat's skull looks like and the reason why there's very little blood. And what are we going to go for? Leopard skull. Okay, how's that, Chandra? Just tell me where to. That good? So what we're looking at particularly here is this little gap between the canines and the premolars. So you can see you've got the long canines there. That little gap is a very special little design, and I'm going to show you what it does now. So those canines anchor on either side of the throat, and they're not what's doing the killing, they're just holding the teeth. What does the killing is the gap. So the gap, what it does is you've got that animal's esophagus like that, and that gap basically pinches it closed. So the canines anchor, and that gap is specially designed over millions of years of evolution to flatten the esophagus and suffocate. That's why you're not getting a lot of blood. If you've ever seen lions and small antelope, where they literally rip it apart, there's just as much blood as you would expect. But on bigger animals, and because they generally use that suffocation hold, they don't really bleed out, they suffocate. So and then that would have dragged it through, and she would have started eating in the rump. And that's muscle with not a lot of blood vessels, so that's why there's not a lot of blood. But very interesting question. Thank you for that, Kathy. So I'm just going to let the other guys know I've checked and that there was nothing there. The stations are checked at Nyama. Off Impala Road, still Lutu there. Then Konzo seemed to head sort of southeast in the block towards Zoe, so I'm gonna go around and have a look there. But I think before we head down to Zoe's to have a look, I might do a little gander past the Sydney's waterhole. See if there's anything happening there. See if we can see some vultures on the ground.
Nothing at all.
Excellent prospect for the sunset safari. So, just a reminder, it is Sunday, so there is going to be a fireside chat this evening. And we're going to be trying something new on fireside chat this evening. So, you've noticed we've done these Facebook catch-ups on certain nights of the week. If we've got something to chat about after drive, we'll do a little chat with everyone. So we're going to try do fireside. We are not going to try. We are going to do fireside chat live from the Safari Live Facebook feed. So it won't be where you normally expect to find it, but it will be on the Safari Live Facebook page. So if you're not sure about that, if you go to the Safari Live Facebook page, there's something that says, I think you need to turn on live notifications. So if we are doing a chat and or a fireside in this one, it'll let you know. Hello, boys. Oh, we got a little bit of fainting. I'm just going to get past them quickly to the open. Looks like they're moving a bit more that way. Ooh, there we go. A little bit more serious than a normal play. So two biggish males, but they don't have any girlfriends, so they're obviously practicing. So even in these little bachelor herds, there will be dominance. Now, from the behavior, the guy closest to us, the one on the right, he seems to be winning. Oh, the table's turned. Not too serious, this fight. Are they going back behind the glory bush? Get back into position. There we go. Keep reversing. Yeah, I think it was a bit more playing. Oh, maybe we'll get some more horn locking. Unfortunately, they're going to back off into a bush. Let's just stand by a little bit to see if they are going to come out. Now we're going to go the other way. Murphy's Law. Lots of fainting. Oh, no. Oh, I think they might. Okay, what's going on? Back behind the bush. Alright, we're going to retreat the other way now. Even the slightest movement gets a reaction from the other. Ah, right. Oh. They do stop to check to make sure they're not being snuck up on by a leopard. Oh, there we go. So Rachel's wondering, at what age will Impala be old enough and strong enough to win a harem? Probably about 2.5, 3, they can start challenging Rachel. It's very difficult to age them once they are adults, though. Here we go. Okay, this doesn't look too serious. We are coming towards the end of the rut, maybe just some remnant testosterone that needs to be worked off. As you're not sure what the rut is when the male impalas fight for the rights to mate with females. And it's all pretty much done by now. So sometimes you get another little late rut in about a month, because some of the females didn't get impregnated during the main rut. So it's quite interesting to know that. And that's why you do get some babies born a little bit later than the others. Let's leave those two to their morning dueling practice and go see what's happening at the waterhole. It looks like those lions went north into Buffalo's Hook. So unfortunately for us, they've left our Travis area, but they could be back at any time. So while we go search to see what's happening on the northern edge of our Travis, let's go see what Jamie's up to way down in the east on Cheetah Plains.
While Brent searches the absolute farthest northern reaches of the Traverse area, we've checked all along the farthest eastern side of our Traverse area. This thing about this big open area, you can spot things from a great distance away. And I've been keeping an eye on this elephant bull that is about to come onto your screens in a moment. We just need to go through this bit of a drainage line in the dip. And then back towards the pan, because it looks as though, from what I could see from very far away, that elephant was actually chasing the zebras away from the water, as they are wont to do. Elephants do just do that. They do tend to bully the poor animals that come across to have a drink at the same time as them. Don't know what it is that causes that. They're just bigger than everything else, I think. And this is a big boy. I wonder if he's the elephant. I saw an elephant through the bushes earlier, but that was quite skittish when it came to the vehicle. And again, with this, he's gone completely still. the zebra clustering on the other side of the pan, as far away from him as they can possibly get. There we go. He's relaxed again a little bit. Because the one thing about this drought is that it's brought through some enormous elephant bulls from Kruger. 30 years and older, all of the water holes to the east of us have dried up, and so they've been forced to head across to the west and into the Swabi Sands. And we are reaping the benefit of that just because there have been so many massive bulls wandering about. He's having a jolly good drink. The biggest creature out here, and probably one of the most unique. Love the zebra looking at him. Justin in Idaho, you were wondering about whether or not the elephant has any relatives out here, and if so, what they might be. The answer is a surprising one. The closest relative to an elephant, we don't see terribly much of here, but you might in other parts of the Swabi Sands or in other parts of the Kruger. You definitely will if you go towards a part of the country called Natal, so towards the coastal regions. It is an animal called a hyrax, a rock hyrax or a tree hyrax, or as we know them colloquially in South Africa, a dassie. And a dassie looks like a rodent. Looks like a rodent, and it's about sort of that big. I mean, they're tiny animals in comparison, and believe it or not, that is the closest relative to an elephant, a rock hyrax or a tree hyrax. The reason, what puts them together in the same or closest sort of family line is their foot structure, the way that elephants walk on the tips of their five toes with a spongy cushion underneath is exactly the same in rock hyraxes. They also have pectoral nipples, in other words, it's between their front legs, rather than between their back legs, as with most of the other animals out here, except for the primates. And then they're also unified by the type of digestive system that they have, bizarrely, and their teeth. The molars and the striations on the molars are one of the things that puts the dassie as the closest relative of an elephant. They look like little rodents. That's totally bizarre. You'd never think that that was the same or the closest relative to an elephant, and yet it is. Just goes to show. The elephants are essentially unique out here. Used to be one of the largest, most successful mammal families in the world, including the woolly mammoth and several other species of ancient elephant ancestors. Now, down to just two, the Indian and the African, or the savannah, yeah, the African elephant and the Indian elephant. And then within the African elephant, two subspecies. We only see the savannah elephants out here, but if you go further into the forested areas of Africa, Gabon, Central African Republic, Congo, you'll encounter things called forest elephants. Very similar in size, but just subtle differences between them. What an interesting situation here playing out with the zebra. So this group, this herd, has managed to drink their fill. However, in the process of coming down for a drink and their encounter with the elephant, one of them has actually become separated from the rest. Now, he's just hidden behind a bush, so I'm going to go forward slightly so we can watch this play out. Hold on. There's a chance that roller's going to roll. It's screeching away. Is he going to do it? No, I don't know what's upset them over there. Chasing away other rollers, I think. There we go. dive bombing another bird species that I suspect is another roller. Well done, Dave. Awesome camera work. And the roller, there we go. Keeping us on our toes and giving a demonstration of why a lilac-breasted roller is called a roller. Because in their mating displays or in their threat displays, they do that almost like a barrel rolling down a hill. They kind of rock vigorously from side to side. Here we go. Well done, Dave. Ah, and our zebra, our separate zebra, has decided to be brave enough now. The group on the right is watching intently. Then we have the elephant in the middle and the zebra wanting to come and drink, but feeling a bit distressed. Might actually, I mean, that's the way that I've interpreted the situation, but there could also be a different reason for its separation. It might actually be a zebra that is not part of that herd. Could be a young male. And I don't come and take it out on me, boy. I'm not doing anything. It's the zebra that'll doing it. Straight up and over the dam wall, and the zebra immediately moving out of his way. The lion always gets called the king of the jungle. Most definitely not. An elephant bull of this size is the undisputed boss of the savannah. There is nothing out here that is a threat to him. Except a human being, of course, but luckily not where we are. Our elephants are completely protected. And that gentle lumbering stride. Well, he's got nowhere to go in a big hurry. Nowhere to be. His only plan for the day is to continue to fill his stomach, maybe find a herd with some females in estrus. A relatively relaxed life that an elephant bull of this size leads. And that almost lazy looking stride looks so slow, is not. If anyone who's ever tried to track an elephant on foot when they're in this kind of mood, when they're moving like this, will know just how fast they do actually cover ground. When your legs are 6 feet long, your strides or 6 feet in between. A gentle stroll on a Sunday morning. Oh, we are having such luck today. We have another jackal with Brent.
So we're in that area around Sydney's, and there's the black-backed jackal again. And I think you saw earlier with Jamie, could be the exact same one. Let me just try to sneak forward. We had a brief glimpse of a side stripe as well, but it was too quick to get on camera. How's that, Chandra? There.
Mic for you.
Just trying to get that visual through the gory thickets. I hope they hang around. It is one of my favorite calls. Oh, it's gonna sit down. Oh, scratchy. Must have fleas. Good scratch, probably a few ticks as well. Been a busy morning trying to scavenge off that buffalo carcass from the hyenas. Now, as it gets warmer, that jackal's probably going to find a nice shady spot amongst these gory thickets to have a snooze. And off he trundles. Morning. Morning, Tony. Let me just swap my hat there before we carry on. So, Tony's wondering how much hunting jackals do themselves. Well, Tony, actually quite a lot. They're incredibly good at... So, is that a jackal track? Nope. Not, unfortunately. So, Tony, they do, especially little rodents, lizards, all sorts of things like that. Jackal will hunt quite a lot. Of course, if there's a carcass to scavenge off, they're adept. And look at this. I think the hyenas have dragged the buffalo back to the den. So I think we're going to go have a look there. Massive drag mark going off here. So heading straight towards the den, so we're definitely going to have a look. Sorry, Tony, about that. I got sidetracked by the drag mark. But they do quite a lot of their own hunting. They also can be quite omnivorous. They'll eat fruit as well. But generally, the blackback prefers carrion and meat. The side stripe is more omnivorous. It eats a lot more fruit and will actually actively seek out certain trees and fruiting species. There is a blackback jackal will eat if it comes across. It won't really actively look for fruit. Okay, so let's go see which den they drag the buffalo to. Mike's wondering how far away could a jackal smell a carcass from? Mike, to give you an exact answer, I'm probably not sure. What probably drew the jackal in this morning were the hyenas making noise and fighting over it. But from smell, I would say it'd have to be within a couple of kilometers. Okay, first den. It doesn't look like anything's here. They may not have dragged it all the way to the den. They might have left it in the bush somewhere. Doesn't look like anything. Nope. No one at home here. There we go. So let's go check the next den along. Okay. Starting to warm up now. Feeling a little bit more human than we were a little while ago. Sandy said she's confused. If hyenas don't mess with jackals and lions don't mess with jackals because they're too fast, what are jackals' predators? Now, they will, and sometimes they do get lucky enough to grab a jackal around a carcass. But I'd say one of the biggest threats to jackals, and actually Brian and I were lucky enough to see it actually happen, but unfortunately it was all fair. We saw the quarantine young male leopard catch and kill a side-striped jackal right next to us. So leopards will kill jackals. Also, not so much when they're adults, but when they're a bit younger, martial eagles and big birds of prey are also quite a threat to the jackals. Okay. Let's have a look. I'm at the second den site now. Not looking too promising, unfortunately. And they could have just dragged it somewhere into the bush to eat. Really hoping they dragged it to the den. Now, spotted hyenas quite often drag things to the den, but not always. Whereas brown hyenas always take stuff to the den. And one of the big differences when looking at a hyena den, it's a brown hyena den as opposed to a spotted hyena den, is the fact that literally brown hyena dens are much smellier and there's just a lot more bones and carrion and skin and everything lying around the den. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like anything is here. But let's hope the hyenas stay focused in this area and don't wander off to where that impala carcass is. Okay, so we're going to leave the den sites and continue on our merry way. Definitely getting quite a bit warmer. I apologize, it's gonna make a little bit of noise on my mic as I unzip my jacket. There we go. So while we continue to check what's here on Ajuma Private Game Reserve, let's go back to Jamie and see what she's up to.
We are slowly meandering back to where we had that leopard at the start of the sunrise safari, and it is still somewhat chilly, reminding us that winter has thoroughly set her teeth into the low veld, and that we're going to have chilly mornings in the future going forward. And just a quick reminder for those of you who haven't been with us for the entirety of the drive, that also means that we will be changing our time on the 1st of June. Now, the sunrise safari will shift forward by half an hour. Now, for those of you on the eastern coast, that puts it at around 3:30 to 3:30 in the morning. And then on the other side, you've got 9:30 in the evening to 12:30 at night. Just that half an hour shift, the sunset safari, so the second of our drives of the day, will stay at exactly the same time period. And if I haven't made that all that clear, or if you're struggling still with the times, or indeed if you have any further questions, you can send those through to #SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And keep those questions flowing, and let's see what else we can find for the last few moments of our sunrise safari. It has definitely warmed right up, or at least it is no longer frigid. There was a moment where Dave and myself were racing towards that leopard, which is still making me a little bit sad, but anyway, I will recover. I just need some time to start to accept it. But when Dave and myself were racing across this leopard, my eyes were streaming, my nose was pouring from the sudden temperature changes as we were going down into those dips and up and out the other side. We're not even in July yet. Brace yourself, Dave. July is the coldest. It's a funny time, winter in the low veld, because your day is still warm enough to walk around in a t-shirt, and yet the mornings and the evenings are particularly chilly, particularly cool. And an elephant bull, by the way, we did go past him while he'd moved off to the bushes, but he'd stopped to feed. And we did go past him, and he was a little bit cheeky. So the assessment of his behavior when he went completely was right. He is not 100% comfortable with cars. I've said that they are the undisputed kings of the savannah out here. I wasn't really going to enter into a battle of wills with him, so we left him and we just carried on. But he did somewhat peculiarly, we're losing our signal, so I'm going to send you back across to Brent.
Copy, thanks. What do you think's my ETA? Sorry guys, just on the radio.
Sorry, go again, Brent.
I just need to get this update and I'll be right back with you. What do you think ETA to you to the cut line is?
The current probably maybe 4 minutes.
Copy, thanks very much for that update, Mike. I'm on my way. Where on Chilicat line would be best access, central or Mamba side?
Yeah, just that road towards the lodge, I mean, that's central.
Copy, thanks. I'm on my way. Guys, really, really exciting news. The Inkahuma is moving her cubs, and it sounds like they're about to come on Juma. Unfortunately, we're not that close, so I'm going to have to do a little bit of low flying to get there. Cubbies! Okay, so if I'm not looking back, because I'm quite moment. And it seems like, not to rub it in to the other presenters, but hopefully my cub luck continues. But while we zoom off there, let's go across to Jamie.
That is wonderful news that the Inkahuma lioness is apparently doing some interesting things on this sunrise safari. So we're going to let Brent race across in that direction, and you'll join me for the moment as we drive along the northern boundary of Cheetah Plains. Obviously we've left the open areas and we've come to what would be described as mixed bush willow woodland. Quite dense up at this part of Cheetah Plains. I'm just really hoping that that female leopard decides to get thirsty. We did, when we entered that sighting, we did have signal right next to the waterhole, which is very, very close to her. So I've been listening to the Game Drive channel. She hasn't moved yet, but there's always a chance before the sunrise safari that she's going to get thirsty and that she's going to wander up towards the water. And that's sort of what I'm hoping for. Interesting little buried treasure that I've just spotted. I love to stop and look at these things because of one particular sighting. I'll jump out and actually get it. It's that in the dirt there on the side of the road. I'm going to have to just disentangle myself, which could be trickier than normal given that I've got a hot water bottle tucked under my jacket. Sorry, hold on one moment. Obviously we have a giant land snail shell there. And the reason I love to go and have a look at these shells is because very often what I've found is they make the perfect place to hide. Oh, this is a huge one. Oh, hold on. I'm going to make sure that this isn't actually, it can't be, not with this level of fading. Oh no, it's just full of dirt. I thought, I had a horrible feeling for 1 second that it was a giant land snail that had gone into estivation. So what these land snails do in winter when it's so dry is they will actually form a mucus-like coating across the top and it becomes very solid and crispy. This is an enormous giant land snail shell. Just look at that in terms of size. Just to give you an idea of how large this snail would have been. This is definitely one of the biggest shells that we've picked up in recent months. Now the reason I went to go and investigate is once before, only once, it's only happened to me once, but I always check now. I actually found in the hollow of the shell, oh, I've just dropped a whole load of dirt down my sleeve, sorry Dave, shifting the shell away from you. I once found some kind of reptile eggs. Now I don't know if they were snake eggs or chameleon eggs or something along those lines, But some reptile, some sort of very industrious reptile, had decided that a land snail shell was the perfect place to go and lay their eggs. An interesting technique, because of course these land snail shells are quite a useful source of calcium. Useful source of calcium for, in particular, female leopard tortoises. So a female leopard tortoise will actually collect and munch on a giant land snail shell. Getting rid of the dust and the dirt. And they'll nibble on that for extra calcium in order to help them boost when they need to lay eggs. And basically they'll go and they'll snack on this. Tortoises will also do that with carcasses as well. Particularly the females, when they're about to lay their eggs, they'll go and they'll munch on either other tortoise shells, the shells of dead tortoises, there we go. Obviously they're not going to go and nibble on a live tortoise shell, as well as bones and other such things, which is one of the big reasons why out here it's important to remember that tortoise shells are, especially if you found a dead tortoise and a tortoise shell, you should actually be quite wary of handling it without then washing your hands straight afterwards. And quite a good carrier of anthrax, but also just general parasites and other types of bacterium. They're not very clean things, tortoise shells. Just a little fact for those of you who are interested in finding tortoises. Now, I haven't seen that many tortoises about, which is pretty natural for us in going into our dry season, but they are still moving around. Their tracks are still in this area. Maybe just on the days where we've had a little bit of drizzle. Come on, Inkanyeni. You know you want to pop out and come and have a drink. I also strongly suspect I found leopard tracks right next to where we found those Nkuruma tracks, and I suspect that it was Tingana that had gone on to kill that impala a little bit further to the west of where I found his tracks. Okay, we've just got to hope now. Are there any stations still with that Mfazi Ingwe outside Cheetah Plains Lodge? Copy that, thanks. Is she still in that Skova? Copy that, thank you. Yeah, I'm just coming up to the lodge clearing now, the pan outside the lodge. I wouldn't mind trying again. Copy that, thank you. Guys, there is a chance we could see her. We're going to push the signal a little bit, but she is out of the drainage line and she's a bit clearer. So what we're going to do is we're going to try and have a look. So far so good, signal holding up. She's no longer in the drainage line. Okay, come on, we can do this. Please signal. I'm trying to go really slowly because in my very limited technological understanding of the way things work, I feel like the slower I go, the better. So we're crawling. We're going to do this. We're going to try. What do you think, Dave?
Yeah,
we're going to get her on camera?
Yes.
Yes, we are. Come on, signal. Hope everybody's sending through their good vibes for this. Oh, that was such a South African accent that just came through there. Bye. Okay.
We're still doing the low flying. I've just heard the lioness and the cubs have crossed into Juma. So I apologize if I'm not looking at you, but we really want to get there. There we go. We're about 3 minutes away. And we got lucky. I was really hoping we didn't hit any elephant traffic jams, and we managed to avoid them. So she's somewhere over here, just north of Mamba Road, coming into Vuyatela. This is such exciting news! And, oh yes, just checking, still have a cameraman. Jan, Jan. Oh, but quickly to Jamie, to a leopard! What?
Yes! Okay, nobody breathe too hard. Dave, keep your movements nice and slow, because we have signal and we have a leopard for you. I'm just too scared to even try to reposition right now. We've got signal here. It might not be the best view in the world, but we have our leopard. And she's come out beautifully onto a big flat rock to come and sunbathe. Hello, girl. I'm so excited. I'm so glad that we managed to make this work. I just had that feeling that we had to try it. I'm too scared to move, which is, of course, ridiculous. But there we go. Here's her round belly. Aww. We're tired, girl. For those of you who missed the start of the sunrise safari, as far as I can tell, this is Inkanyeni. That's what I've been told as well. So this is the first time I have ever seen her today. Now, this morning we did find her, but unfortunately, well, Mike actually from Cheetah Plains found her for us, and when we relocated her, and unfortunately we just didn't have signal at the bottom of the drainage line system that she was in, which meant that we couldn't put her on your screens. But she's very kindly moved up and out of the drainage line. She has a dead bush buck in there that she's been feeding on. And she's obviously eaten her fill for now, and judging by that round belly, I think that she is quite content. Yes, so excited. Absolutely thrilled that we did manage to get her on camera. She might not have gone up for a drink, but she did come up for the sun's warmth. I'm just assessing the situation to try and see if repositioning to get you a better view is possible. I don't think so, however. I don't think that that is going to work terribly well. I think that we will, for now, just accept our position and our lot in life and be grateful that we got it. Here's the tuft of white underneath her tail, and then that beautiful marvel of evolution that is a leopard's coat. Those spots are capable of making, it's almost like an invisibility layer that they can turn on and off at will. When a leopard goes walking into bushes or into grass, they just vanish. It is the most, to me, it is the most effective camouflage that any animal out here, okay, any mammal out here demonstrates. Yes, there are certain insect types that are almost impossible to see that maybe could be considered to be slightly more camouflaged. But a leopard is the master of secrecy. When they want to be, of course. Sometimes, just as she's done now, they kindly present themselves on a warm, flat surface. Just the barest hint of movement from her ears and from her tail. What an lucky, lucky way for us to finish off our sunrise safari. Thank you very much, girl. It was, whether you realized it or not, exceptionally considerate of you to decide to pop out here. Hear one of the other vehicles moving out of the sighting. They've managed to find a spot on the opposite side of the river system. I don't think that will work for us, however. Having a quick lick. Well, the animals of the Sabi Sands playing wonderfully with us this morning. Brent has found his lioness. Let's head to him.
So, there we go, the Inkoma lioness. That's got the little three little cubs. They're not with her. She's left them just on the other side of our boundary, but they are closer than they were. But very exciting that she's back on Juma. She's out hunting at the moment. And she might hear something in the thickets here. There's quite a lot of general game in this area, waterbuck, impala. Definitely stalking something. We can't see what it is just yet. She might have heard something rather than seen something, just judging from her behavior. She's listening, as I said, she's heard animals moving up ahead. I don't think she's spotted them yet. And she hasn't dropped her shoulders into that very classic lion stalk just yet. But she is more alert and showing interest. She's slowly going. See how carefully she places her feet. So she's going into some thick areas. I don't want to follow her while she's hunting. She's got three little mouths to feed. So least we got to see her, but let's go back to Jamie and the leopard for the last few moments of this show. So from Jandre and myself, we'll see you soon on the Sunset Safari.
And perfect timing as our leopardess lifts up her head to glance around her. I think she's going to get too hot quite quickly, but there we've got a relatively good view of her face, considering exactly our position and our predicament. I am so thrilled that this worked out this morning and that I have broken my leopard drought on camera as well as off camera. And not only that, but she provides us with fantastic prospects for the sunset safari, since there's a good chance she's still going to be in this area, and hopefully, if she continues to play nicely, in a place where we can come and have a look at her. Now, my first time seeing Nkanyeni, and maybe if we're really lucky, there's the possibility of her going to fetch her cubs and bringing them back to us. You never know, and you'll just have to stay tuned for the sunset safari in order to find out. I do hope so. Just looking at her profile, slightly longer face and snout than Karula's family line has. Karula, Shadow and Tandi, so Karula's two daughters, the leopards that we see the most of around the Juma area, have slightly different profiles to this female leopard. And it's always exciting. We love seeing our regular characters, but it's exciting to add a new one to our list of animals that we can look forward to watching over the next few months and over the next few years. She thought about getting up there. There was a big sigh, the flies are plaguing her. or not. Or she just thought about finding a more comfortable place to rest her head. We shall leave her to her sunbathing at the end of our sunrise safari and keep our fingers crossed that she will be here when we return this afternoon. She's still got plenty of food, so our hopes are high. Thank you to Dave for all of his fantastic camera work. Thank you, Dave. And for trusting and believing in this leopard. It worked out well. We made it happen. And thank you to Rebecca and Lou in final control. And most importantly, thank you to all of you across the globe who are joining us for these safaris. I'm going to leave you with the visual of this beautiful leopard as a great way to finish off. Bye-bye.